This seminar is entirely different from the other conducted seminars because of its specialized drama teacher as a mission. Any conference, not at all conferences actually, they also have a mission, but unspecified, that is optional. Each and every conference should result in knowledge dissemination, knowledge acquisition, knowledge adoption, then implementation by concerned authorities. But here specifically we have mentioned that there is a mission. So that means that will be conducted at several places on several issues, several values on several angular perspective and perception will be handled till we get the solution. And even after getting the solution, for perennial flow of the solution and its sustenance, as the world is ever changing, so it is a lifetime project. Mission means as long as the earth that sustains with its revolution and rotation on its axis and orbit, this should be carried, or this will be carried any name at any place by any other person. Somehow it will be ever existing, as eternal as God Himself. Because I always used to say, I used to bifurcate the conferences into two things, or two major sectors. One is propositional, second is impositional. Whenever they organize very nicely, I will organize some programs which will excellently be well organized, like religious programs in which there is individual benefit, like relief from planetary tenacity, relief from their illness and other mundane hurdles. For such things there will be a thronging crowd. So unless I am satisfied, organizing the same seminar with the same topic, probably at the same auditorium, is known as impositional conferences. So we are very dynamic and this energetism is unfading. But still it serves as a material. What we believe is Anu Bhadra Kartavo Yanti Vishwataha. It has two meanings. Let all noble thoughts come from all sides to me. That also implies that let my noble thoughts permeate each and every corner, direction of the sphere. That is the implied second meaning. So considering the second meaning, I believe that more than the listeners, that of other people, unknown people, strangers, there are silent spectators, there are other helpless people in the society, we believe that our speech, the radiance inside the speech, the veritability and depth inside the speech, will be converted into such a configurating urge which will reach all of these people and immigrate them, and one day we are going to casually, incidentally, or coincidentally, or coincidentally going to meet them. So believing on these paranormal phenomena of phono radiation and permeation and spiritual integrity systems, we used to conduct a lot of programs without minding anything at all. First of all, I have to define what is India and what is mission. What is India's mission and what is India's actual mission? Then only I will go to the topic. What is India? India has different dimensions. The technology of India is different. The trend of India is different. The taste of India, that is different. The treasure of India is different. The tradition of India is different. Here this India's century mission, according to me, or according to a normal prudential view, it defines only two things. One is the valuable treasure, and second is the unbreakable lineage of tradition. So treasure and the so-called tradition which carries the treasure, both of these things must be revitalized, and lack of connectivity to the lineage must be compensated by means of reconnectivity by capable tools, and to bring back the glory, to enrich, not to create a scienceless world or technology free world. To give companionship, to give security to science and technology, we need our tradition, we need our treasure. So to comfort the whole global society, to comfort the scientific community to go in the pathway of precision and assertivity, without getting into trial and error, permutation and stages. So we are mentioning only these two things. And also the mission is of five components. First thing, to get the fullest details about our treasure, and probably the problems with the spiritualism is, we used to quote, spiritual experiences are metaphysical and scriptural messages are metaphorical. So these metaphysical experiences and metaphorical depictions that is there in scriptures and spiritualism, that has made more or less most of the common society to think it as a mystery or a myth or a deception or a non-existing entity or something which is thrusted into obsoleteness. But it is not so. Just as I used to say, I can deliver a lecture, but somebody can process it and they can give it in a palatable form. Likewise, there must be a mediator between the scriptures and common people, those who are converting the scriptural messages into palatable, delicious, sumptuous, impregnated, informative and efficacious tools for the effective functioning of the whole social mechanism. So what we lack is only a mediator between common society and these things. Thus there is a big rock and there is a weak person. We need a crane. By operating a crane, even a weak person, he can press the button of the crane. He cannot lift the stone. He can press the button of the crane and it will lift that. So we need a mediator, a lever, a pulley, a fulcrum, which we explained, we discussed in the morning. So we need such a system which will induce work efficiency and reduce risk efficiency. So that type of mediation we want to produce. So first thing is collection of materials. Second thing is orderliness of material. We have to order everything. There are voluminous treatises in Shastras. The 14 Vidyas, 64 Kalas, then interpretations in the form of Sutra Parampara, Vritti Parampara, Bhashya Parampara, Vyakhyana Parampara, Anuvakhyana Parampara, Tika Parampara, Tippani Parampara, Vivarana Parampara, Vishama Parampara, Vimarsha Parampara, Paramarsha Parampara, Tarka Parampara, Akshepa Parampara, Samadhana Parampara, Purvoksha Parampara, Siddhanta Parampara. So it is ever continuing debate and journey in spiritual knowledge and its hierarchy. So somebody must encapsulate all of these things into brevity without losing the orderliness and content value. So first is collection, second is orderly presentation, third thing is translation. Mantras can be translated. There are three things in the Vedas. One is might or the force. Second thing is mantra or the phono-vibals or the phono-viewing factors which deal into efficacy. Mantras are said to be predetermined or pre-arranged phonetic transmissions, which without the interception or intervention of any act or manual operation directly produces the effect. So what is mantra and tantra? You think, you do and get is known as tantra. You think and get without doing, the thought process itself, it does the work. Such a hypervalent situation is called as mantra and mantric effect. So the Vedas, they have might or power by means of rituals and realization. They have mantras by contemplation and repetitive pronunciation. They have messages for understanding. Messages can be translated for following. Mantras can be translated for provoking a person's desire, but mantras are to be systematically practiced. So we have to cull out the various proportions and portions of the Vedas and we have to give a clear ideology to the public. Second thing is orderly placement of message of Veda, the might of Vedas, the mantras of Vedas with proper annotation and simplification. Then by means of translation to regional languages, it should reach how a party is catching a whole country. What was the position of the party leaders and parties before few decades? How they have done? Because they have adopted three things. They have no place barrier, they have no comb barrier, they have no language barrier. At any place, in any language, any number of times, they are ready to invade like Ghazali Muhammad till they get the benefit. So that type of enthusiasm and commitment for